Thank you. You may be seated. Well, we just sang something
that could be really scary or very comforting, that he sees the depths of our hearts and he loves us the same. So however you want to process that this morning, we hope that during this time you'll be able to do that. We're glad to be here at Highlands. Our mission is to meet people where they are in their spiritual journey, help them understand what it means to know Christ, and to understand what it means to walk with a God who knows us and loves us, that we are indeed loved moral failures. And because of the grace of God that has been shown to us through Christ, we can come in the morning and celebrate and rejoice in the goodness that is before us. So we're going to have a moment of silent prayer and reflection as we prepare to hear a call to worship. So I invite you to bow your heads and hearts silently and just ask God to make his truth real to you during this time this morning. Let's bow our heads. I invite you to stand, give ear to the word of God.
Today's call to worship is Psalm 98. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. For his right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity.
And you just heard something that may bring great fear or great comfort as we understand that God is coming to judge the earth. The scripture is not shy about proclaiming the salvation goes forth for all the earth. And we are rejoicing and privileged to be here this morning to worship this great and mighty God as we lift our voices to him.
Okay, well, this first song we'll sing in both English and in Spanish. Kimberly just read, at all the ends of the earth, seeing the salvation of God. So one way we remind ourselves that, teach our kids that, practice that, is that we sing sometimes in another language. It reminds us that the King of all the nations is our King. So as we sing in Spanish, we're just going to sing a direct translation of what we've already sung in English. And before we go, song, just one more encouragement to you. Psalms are full of encouragement for God's people to lift up their holy hands in worship. I was just reading Psalm 134 this morning. Lift up your holy hands. So as we sing and we'll praise the Lord's name, feel free to do that as we sing. All right.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Father, calling your love for us amazing is really not doing it justice. It is so far beyond that. We don't have the words to describe the greatness, the wonder of your love for us. That you saw us in our helpless and hopeless condition, and while we were yet sinners, while we were enemies, while we were hostile to you, while we were dead, you sent your son to die for enemies. That's something that is just so far beyond what we could imagine, because we certainly couldn't see ourselves doing that. And that's one reason why we confess before you the coldness of our own hearts, our own lack of love for you and for others, failure to live up to the standard that you gave us, that we are to love one another as Christ loved us. We are to love you with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. So, Father, as we come to sing your praise and rejoice in the goodness of the gospel, we acknowledge our need, Holy Spirit, that you would show us if there be words, thoughts, actions that have been displeasing to you that we have not dealt with, that this would be a time for that this morning. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we rejoice in your goodness, your love for us, and give you all the praise through Christ our Lord. Amen. A couple of ministry highlight reminders. If you want to be involved in the suppers for six, please go on Realm or email the church and let us know. There have been a number of folks you have. We're going to cut it off by the end of this week so we can get things organized with the group. So this will be the last, you know, to even get engaged with any of that before January. So if you come in later than this week, we'll just put you down for starting in January with a new rotation. Just a reminder, Sunday school continues this morning. Elementary age in the fellowship hall, 3 through 5 downstairs. For those ladies and men who participated last week, go back to where you were last week. There were a couple of ladies groups here, one downstairs in the nursery for moms with, you know, nursery age kids, men in a couple of rooms downstairs. If you were not here last week but want to participate, ladies, stay up here and one of the group leaders will grab you. Men, go downstairs and one of the group leaders will grab you and put you in the group as well. There are offering baskets in the foyer. For those who have been giving, we appreciate that. Very faithful giving during these times. And just a reminder, you can RSVP for next week. It does help us in terms of the planning for Sarah. That's all we got in terms of ministry highlights. Bill Brown, one of our ruling elders, is going to come and lead us in congregational prayer. So invite him to come and join us.
Good morning, Highland. Franklin Graham is believing that our nation is at a critical juncture. He is suggesting that we need to call out to God for his help, his intervention, and his mercy, and urging followers of Jesus Christ to fast and pray for our nation this Sunday, October 25th, 2020. Mary and I are attempting to join him. I would like to recommend for your consideration and your reading, Harbinger 2. The author is Jonathan Cahn. The essence of his message is America needs to return to God. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. We thank you, Father, that at the founding of America, our founders made a covenant with God based on Israel's covenant with God. I thank you, Father, that Jonathan Winthrop, a Puritan governor of the Massachusetts Bay Colony, would write, "Thus stands the cause between God and us, that inasmuch as they followed in the paths of righteousness and kept the ways of God, and the blessings of heaven would follow their land." Father, Winthrop's prophecy also held a warning that we shall deal falsely with our God in his work we have undertaken, and so cause him to withdraw his present help from us. We shall be made a story and a byword through the world. We shall surely perish. Father, America has fallen in my lifetime more than yours, having offered up 60 million unborn children as America fell away from God, worshiping American gods, American idols of pleasure, sensualities, carnalities, self-gratification, lusts, profit gain, and material possessions. Two, Father, on June 26, 2015, the Supreme Court took the covenant of marriage as it had been known and upheld for ages and brought it to its end. Its essence, its core, its covenantal bond of male and female was with one act struck down, the reason for its existence nullified and sacred vessel annulled. God, we trust the words of 2 Chronicles 7:14 for America. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Father, I would like to pray this morning Lincoln's April 30th, 1863, proclamation to God for such a time as this in America. Whereas it is the duty of nations as well as of men to own their dependence upon the overruling power of God, to confess their sins and transgressions in humble sorrow, yet with assured hope that genuine repentance will lead to mercy and pardon, and to recognize the sublime truth announced in the Holy Scriptures and proven by all history, that those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord. We have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever known. We have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand that preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to God that made us. It behooves us then to humble ourselves before our offended God, to confess our national sins, and to pray for clemency and for forgiveness. Father, we pray for Christ's church that our pastors might preach the gospel with boldness. We pray with our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world. Father, we pray for wisdom for our local, state, and national leaders. We thank you, God, for your attributes and for your sustaining grace here at Highlands. We praise God that Abigail is home from the hospital following the birth of twins, Olive and Bonnie. We pray for relief, healing, and peace of heart for Mary Ann. We pray for Chris's full healing and recovery following his surgery and radiation treatment. We pray God's grace and peace will guard Guy's heart and mind as he recovers from an amputation procedure on his lower right leg. We pray for all of our students and teachers in their various school environments. We pray for Jeanne as she recovers from her recent foot surgery. Finally, Father, I would like to pray for Pastor Tom's message that it might lead us to become more like Jesus. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forevermore. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we join in song, and I believe this is taken from Psalm 34. And if we do have the live stream in the fellowship hall, if you or your kids get antsy, feel free to just roam on down there, and you can continue to worship with us.
Thank you.
Amen. That's just one more reason for that being one of my favorite psalms right there. Thank you. We appreciate the music team for their faithfulness every week and hard work to come in and practice and lead us. So we're in James, James chapter 1. I think this is week number 7 in James, and so we're making our way through chapter 1. We'll eventually get to chapter 2 sometime. You've probably heard the old saying that God gave us one mouth and two ears so that we might listen more than we talk. We don't necessarily apply that, but today we're going to see the biblical basis for that old saying. You can open your Bibles to James chapter 1 or follow along on the screen, beginning with verse 18. In the exercise of his will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, so that we would be a kind of first fruits among his creatures. This you know, my beloved brethren. But everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all the remains of wickedness, in humility receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. News alert from James here, and that is, we see the reality that Christians struggle with sin. Sometimes, even serious sin. Does that surprise you? If we know our own hearts, it shouldn't surprise us, but sometimes we do act sort of surprised. As if, you know, we're just shocked to find out that there is sin going on in the lives of people who were professed Christians. Robert Rayburn uses illustration, says, Christians are like spiritual plumbers. We have to give attention to the water that is flowing into the system, as well as give attention to the sewage and the muck that is flowing out and dealing with our own hearts. And if we take the grace of God and the provisions of God for granted, then we might easily lose sight of our need for the pure water of the word to be coming in as the filth is going out from our hearts. We see it coming out through our hearts and in our own mouths. And if we ignore that, we really get in trouble. As a young believer, one of the first verses that I memorized is 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I remember this being at a Campus Crusade meeting at UGA, the beginning of my sophomore year, going to a class, and they shared this verse with us. I was a real young believer. That verse is the Christian's bar of soap. Well, it's also the Christian's bottle of Drano, okay? In terms of it, if we confess our sins, often it is our sin that is undealt with that clogs us up spiritually. It sort of clogs the pipes of our spiritual lives. And James is telling us that we will know that our pipes are clogged when we see the sludge of anger, pride, unbridled tongue, filthiness, and all sorts of evil. James begins with the reality that a big part of the sewage that clogs things up is that pride makes us talkers. Now, honestly, this is really hard for me because I make my living talking. So James also is going to tell us in another chapter that not many of you should be teachers because there incurs greater, you know, accountability, but we won't talk about that right now. We are apt to talk at people rather than talk with them. We all suffer from what Stephen Sample, in his book, The Contrarian's Guide to Leadership, he calls three delusions. We suffer with the delusion that we are good drivers. We suffer from the delusion that we all have a good sense of humor. And we suffer from the delusion that we are all good listeners. James is assuming that his audience is, maybe they're not great listeners. That's why he writes these verses to them. They suffer from the same delusion. Not caring for each other by humbly listening during trials brings a negative impact on relationships. And that's one of the things that James is concerned about. He's pointing to the symptom of a much deeper issue that is noted in these verses we just read. The deeper issue is not humbly receiving and listening to the Word of God in our lives. That is the real foundational issue that we have to be aware of. So let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. And James points out, he says, everyone. So this is for all of us. It's as if James were up here, he would be looking each one of you in the eye this morning and looking at me in the eye this morning so that we all understand this is for us. It's great advice for marriage and parenting and for childing, okay? Be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. If Christians or those who are professed Christians just practiced that verse, the world would stand up and take notice and be attracted to the gospel. I mean, what a practical way to be salt and light in the world if we who profess Christ were to be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Last week, we were talking about anger as well last week, and had someone come up to me after the service and say, I just knew you were talking about me. And I was afraid you were going to call me out or that everybody was automatically during the sermon just going to look over in my direction because they all knew who you were talking about. Well, there may be a number of you who are thinking that was talking about you, but this person actually voiced that. James, in his writing, gets very personal. And so maybe as you read, as we hear these verses, you might think, oh no, has Tom been, you know, listening in on some of my conversations? No, just tell him what James is telling us here. He gets very personal, and he's really sort of goes from meddling to preaching to meddling in our lives when he goes through some of this stuff. When it comes to these verses, you may feel like some of the lyrics from the group Superdrag. Anybody heard of Superdrag? Yeah, I hadn't either. Hat tip to Jason Norrell. Where is he? He was here. He's in the fellowship hall. Thank you, Jason, over there. Last week he told me, you know, there's a song from Superdrag in their album Industry Giants, and the name of the song is Quick to Hear, Slow to Speak, Slow to Anger. And so he sent me the link, and I looked at the words, and part of the chorus goes like this. Slow to speak, slow to anger, the opposite of how I feel, the opposite of how I live. There's no justice in this deal, something infinitely greater. Now, have you ever felt that way? That's not how I feel, and it's not how I live, slow to speak and slow to anger. And I don't know much about Superdrag, but at least they pointed to something. This is something infinite that is going on here. As James points out, this is all tied to the connection of our hearts in relationship to God Himself and His Word. James here in this passage introduces the issue of the tongue. And he touches on the issue of the tongue in each chapter of his book. So we're going to be hearing a lot about that. James exposes what our speech implies about our hearts. And if this simple command, well, simple in the phraseology, quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger, were applied in tone and content and conversations and posts on social media, things would change dramatically. If it were only applied by Christians, things would change dramatically. So let me paraphrase this verse for 20th century people. Let everyone be quick to hear, slow to hit send, slow to anger. Untold damage is done to the church, to the world, to relationships when this command is ignored. Think of how many marriages and families would be enriched if this simple verse were applied on a regular basis. So let me encourage you, memorize that verse. Memorize those short little phrases. Let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. Meditate on them. And this is one of those areas where, you know, I am preaching to myself as much as anyone else. These verses are particularly needed during times of trial. Now, James has spent a lot of time talking about trials. And he goes to these verses. He said, well, what is the connection here? Well, because we need these verses in times of trial. Because it's during times of trial and testing and difficulty that we tend to not be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. There's a lot of talk today about how there's so much hostility on the surface in our society. And there's certainly a lot of truth to that. But, you know, I listen to a fair amount of history podcasts, and one thing I've learned is that nothing has really changed much. This our era today is not totally unique to our age. What makes it so pronounced is the technology of the internet that makes it seem more pronounced. This is the 503rd anniversary, you know, October 31st, 503rd anniversary of, you know, the launching of the Reformation, October 31st, 1517, Martin Luther. Imagine if Luther and his opponents had the internet 500 years ago. I mean, they barely had the printing press and it changed the world. But imagine if they had the internet and Luther and his opponents had Facebook and Twitter. Honestly, I think they may have made us look rather tame. Now, I know there are a number of Hamilton fans here in this room or maybe watching online. What would it have been like if Hamilton and Burr or Hamilton and Jefferson had had Twitter and Facebook? I mean, talk about Twitter blew up because of whatever was said. Well, you know, as we remember from the storyline, Hamilton was actually killed in a duel by the sitting vice president. We think things are bad today. Folks, we got to keep a little bit of historical perspective. In Luther's day, if you disagreed with the powers that be, the politically correct powers that be or whatever, the penalty might be that you were burned alive. So we can be thankful that we have not reached that stage. Yet, the way of the world, and too often the way of the church, for the last 15, 20, 100, thousands of years, has always been this. Let everyone be slow to hear, quick to speak, quick to anger. That is the state of the natural heart. James is writing to implore his brethren and sistren to change the cultural mantra, to change the cultural paradigm of how we are to behave. And so his words written to this audience, those words are ringing in our ears today as well. Trials tend to provoke quick speech and quick anger. So we need to be on the alert during trials. Being slow to speak guards against relational temptation and sin. So about 2 years ago, during the fall season in our Sunday school, we did cross groups like we'll be doing right now. And during that series of the cross groups, at least for the men's and I think maybe as well for the ladies, if you finish sort of through the cycle there, we did a eulogy exercise. And if you remember that, the eulogy exercise is this. Imagine if you could be at your funeral, okay, sitting in the balcony listening, and people who knew you best were given 5 minutes or so to stand up and say something about you. What would you want to hear them say? You know, okay, that's a scary thought as well. It would be a great thing if at our funerals, people stood up and said, he or she was quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. If people remembered nothing about us except that, what an amazing legacy to leave to a family. Now, this is something that could only be explained by the Holy Spirit if that is going to take place in our lives. Now, when we encounter these verses here in verse 19 and 20, or verses 2 through 4, to consider it all joy when you encounter various trials, let me ask you this. When you encounter those verses, is your first response to say, Lord, I need you to make this happen in my life? I want to see this happen, but I need you to do it. Or is your first response to begin to negotiate with God and try to explain to God why those verses don't really apply in your situation right now? That God did not foresee your particular trial coming down the pike when he gave those verses. So what's your first response? To say, Lord, I want that. I need you. Help me. Or just to try to renegotiate with God what you're supposed to do, what he is requiring of us. You know, God is not asking us to do something that he himself does not do. Psalm 103, beginning with verse 8, it says this, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. So the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he himself knows our frame. He is mindful that we are but dust. Friends, if the God of the universe views us and treats us this way, how then ought we to treat those around us? If God can be this slow to anger and compassionate, shouldn't we be that way? Quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger is a description of God himself. It's also a description of the Lord Jesus Christ. In 1 Peter 2, read a couple of verses, beginning with verse 21. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. While being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. In order to amplify or sort of clarify the sinlessness of Jesus, he's quoting from the Old Testament, Isaiah 53, it points out, nor is any deceit found in his mouth. And then in chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, Peter's been talking about husbands and wives, and he says this, to sum up, let all be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead. For you were called for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing. So, quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger is a description of God. It's a description of the Lord Jesus Christ. The anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God, is what he tells us. There is such a thing as righteous anger. Jesus, we see, when he cleared the temple with the whip of cords, it was righteous anger. But if we're honest, most of us, me included, or me especially, we don't have enough experience with that kind of truly righteous anger to even be qualified to say much about it. Alec Motier, in his book on James, he writes this, general human anger is heavily impregnated with sin, self-importance, self-assertion, intolerance, stubbornness. When anger comes in, listening flies out. That kind of anger, that sinful, selfish, self-righteous anger doesn't serve anyone. Let me ask you this. Can you think of a time, a situation, where you actually really helped someone through an expression of unrighteous anger. My guess is we would all probably come up empty on that. But, you know, we like to say that, well, my anger was righteous. Really? Or was it impregnated with self-importance, self-assertion, intolerance, stubbornness in the things that our agenda? Anger, think of Socrates who said, anger corrodes the box that contains it. So if you need to express your anger, let me encourage you to do this. Do it to God. Do it with God, okay? First of all, God can take it. And secondly, he's the one you're mad at anyway. So I'm not mad at God. I'm mad at, you know, that idiot over there that did blah, blah, blah. You know, kids, don't call anybody an idiot, just saying, okay? But I'm mad at that person. Really? You know, ultimately we're mad at God because God is in control of all things. God is the one who is sovereign over all things. I heard this years ago. It made so much sense. It was really quite convicting. When you honk your horn in anger, you're really honking at God. Okay? Just think about that one a little bit. Anger is a deeply theological issue. At the root of our rage, at the root of our anger is a sense that I deserve better. That should not have happened to me. How dare he? How dare she? How dare they? Don't they know who I am? Anger is released when we try to defend our pride, our righteousness, our desire, or our reputation. And honestly, those are the things that sent Jesus to the cross anyway. You know, they may not know who we are and what we deserve, but God does. And you know what God's judgment, what God's evaluation is of what we deserve? We deserve death and hell. But praise be to God that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It's all of grace. Everything this side of hell is grace. We get angry to the extent that we forget or we deny what we really deserve. We forget that we are bigger sinners than we dare admit. We forget what Jonathan Edwards said long ago in one of his resolutions. Edwards, he was about age 19 when he started writing his 70 resolutions. I forget which number this one is, but it reads this way. Resolved to act in all respects, both speaking and doing, as if nobody had been so vile as I. As if I had committed the same sins or had the same infirmities or failings as others. And that I will let the knowledge of their failings promote nothing but shame in myself. And prove only an occasion of my confessing my own sins and misery to God. Wow, that is pretty mature thinking for a 19-year-old or a 20-year-old or a 35-year-old or a 60, 70, 80-year-old. To let someone else's sin only become an occasion for me to reflect on my sin. That's very challenging. Verses 19 and 20 show us what maturity or being perfect and complete looks like. And James gives us two commands. Two intentional acts that we are to engage in. First is rejection of all sin and filthiness. The doctrine of and danger of sin is well chronicled in the book of James. He does not hold back. He does not, you know, spare anything. He's very much upfront about the reality of sin. He never softens his language on sin. And so we must learn to identify habits and manifestations of sin in our own lives. What are they? To put away all filthiness and an abundance of evil. See, James has opened the door to an understanding of sin, but now we have to do sort of our part to have the spiritual and emotional courage to recognize and identify what our own part is, what our own sin is, where our struggles are. And friends, we're all different. We'll all struggle in different ways. We must be willing to do the soul-searching work for this to happen. And honestly, it can be scary. I mean, it's certainly scary for me. So what are your specific struggles? Well, what are things, you know, that I particularly struggle with? The Westminster Confession, in talking about repentance, says that we are to confess our particular sins particularly. Not just say, oh God, I'm a sinner, but to be open, be, you know, have the reception, say, Holy Spirit, show me, search me, try me, know my thoughts, oh God. Show me where the sin is. And now here's a spiritual life tip. You will never be able to find progress or, you know, to find victory over an area of sin, growth in an area of sin, until you name it and speak it to at least one other person. If you think, well, I'm just, you know, I've struggled with such and such, and I'm just going to keep this between me and God, that's just not going to work. I've heard too many testimonies of people who have said, well, I tried for so long just to try to keep this between me and God, and it's not until it is put out there with at least one other person that we begin to find real progress to take place. Galatians 6 says we're to bear one another's burdens. James 5 talks about confessing our sins to one another. James 5:19 says this, my brothers and sisters, if any one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover a multitude of sins. That's not going to happen unless we're honest and are willing to admit to at least one other person. Clearing away all known sin is a way to clear the path for the reception of the Word of God. We cannot humbly receive the Word if we are guarding and fondling sin in our hearts. So James says, put away the sin. Now the second command he gives is humbly receive the Word of God, the reception of God's Word. James is laying out for us what it looks like to be a follower of Christ. As one who's had the Word implanted in our souls, all of the resources of God are at our disposal in our battle with sin. But the catalyst in the midst of this is the Word. Psalm 119:11 says, thy Word I have treasured in my heart that I might not sin against you. The Spirit works with the Word as a catalyst to stir up and to help clear these things out in our lives. You know, James doesn't give a Bible reading plan. You know why? Because there was really no Bible such as we know it today. There was the Old Testament, but who had a full copy of that? No, nobody. People had to hear the Word and memorize it for it to sink into their hearts. But what he does give is he gives attention to what is the most important, and that is humbly receiving the Word. The most important thing about coming to worship on Sunday morning is not how you look, if you got here exactly on time, or where you are seated. The most important thing is, are we humbly receiving the Word of God? That's the preparation that needs to take place in our hearts as we're getting ready on Sunday morning or Saturday night and coming here on Sunday morning. That's the preparation as we walk through the doors, is to say, God, I need to humbly receive your Word. How did the Word become implanted? Verse 18 says, by his own will. This speaks of the God's miracle of regeneration in our hearts. The Word of God is not native to the natural heart. God has to give new birth by which the Word is implanted. It is this work of God that will incline our hearts to the Word. 1 Peter 2 says this, therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babes, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. Ignoring the word is much more dangerous than we think, because we become vulnerable to all of the temptations that come along with trials. We become vulnerable to all of these things. And you know where that temptation shows up most often? In our speech, and in this day and age, on our social media post. So before we say anything, before we hit sin, we should ask ourselves this question by way of self-awareness. Is it biblically true? Does it reflect a desire to listen? Or does it mainly reflect personal feelings, fears, and condemnation of others? God gives a new heart. He does that. And He demands that we crave the pure milk of the Word so that we would grow in respect to salvation. This craving is not automatic. And it can be squelched by feeding our hearts other stuff. Just like you tell your kids 20 minutes before dinner time, no, you cannot have those cookies. No, you cannot have whatever. It's going to spoil your dinner. Well, in the same way, if we are filling our hearts and our minds with sort of junk, then it's going to spoil our spiritual appetite. Now, the Valley of Vision, which I love to quote, and the particular prayer contentment, offers a more theologically worded understanding than the Beach Boys' Help Me, Rhonda. Now, it sort of gets to the same place that I talked about last week with Help Me, Rhonda. They makes a similar point. It's just that it's a little more theologically grounded. And that is, we can't just say no to sin. We must replace it with something better, something of greater value, and that is Jesus, not our own righteousness. And this is what part of that prayer says. When thy Son, Jesus, came into my soul, instead of sin, he became more dear to me than sin had formerly been. His kindly rule replaced sin's tyranny. Teach me to believe that if ever I would have any sin subdued, I must not only labor to overcome it, but must invite Christ to abide in the place of it. He must become to me more than vile lust had been, that his sweetness, power, life may be there, that I must seek a grace from him contrary to sin, but must not claim it apart from himself. Friends, what this prayer shows and what Scripture shows is that the Christian life is a life meant to be lived in deep intimacy with Jesus Christ, not with a list of do's and don'ts, but a deep intimacy with Christ. That when we find ourselves in a place of the vile lust, whatever that may be, and vile lust doesn't necessarily mean what comes to your mind when you hear the term vile lust, but when we find ourselves in a place of that sort of temptation, we need to invite Christ. Jesus, here, meet me in this place of where I'm impatient. Meet me in this place of my fear. Meet me in this place of my worry, of my anger, of my vile lust, whatever it may be. Inviting Jesus to come in and see his sweetness, his grace, his power. As I read that prayer, do you ever pray that way? I would not know how to pray that way. That's why I read like the Valley of Vision and the Psalms, because they teach me and push me how to pray in ways that I would never know how to excuse me. I would never know how to do. Now we have before us the table. And what this table represents is indeed inviting Christ to come in and to commune with him. As we come to the table, as it says, do this in remembrance of me. We come to the table, and this is sort of as clear a way as God could make it for us to invite Christ and to feed on him. Jesus gave us these elements, these ordinary elements, to remind us of who he is and what he has done for us. And as we come to receive the bread and the cup, it's a reminder of what he has done for us. And so this
bread, Jesus said on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and said, "This bread is my body which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup. Said, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood shed for remission of sin." Now, obviously, the manner and the means in which they celebrated that first communion were very different from what we have here today. But you should have on your rows the communion elements are there. Now, let me just, by word of reminder from what God's Word says, that we're to come and eat and drink, discerning the body and blood of Christ. Which means, first of all, we have to know Him as our Savior and Lord. And if you don't know Him as your Savior and Lord, then Scriptures say, don't partake. This is not for you. Just let it pass. And if you've been admitted to the table by a believing church, then that would be an indication that, okay, this is for you. Because it's not just the table of Highlands. It's the table of the Lord. But even if you know Christ, but you're saying, "God, I don't want to be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. I kind of like being quick to anger." If that's your attitude, then Scripture would say, you're not really discerning what's going on here. And you best not partake right now, lest you eat and drink judgment to yourself. But this is a table and an opportunity to say, "Lord, I know what your word says. I want to receive it humbly. And I need your grace to do that." This is a means by which we can invite Christ to be in the place of whatever the vile sin may be that we're struggling with, perhaps even this morning. So let's pray silently, and as you ask God to work in your hearts as we prepare to receive the elements. Father God, you know our hearts. Search us, try us, see if there be any hurtful way. Take these elements, common elements of bread and juice, and use them that we might feed upon Christ spiritually and fellowship with Him in the power of your Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite the music team, if you'd come forward and you have your elements you can bring with you, and they will get ready to lead us in a song of reflection. And as they are playing and as we are singing, please partake of the bread as you like. We have extra gluten-free bread is here. If you did not receive enough of the cups with the wafer with it, for your row, raise your hand. Bill Brown has some extras. He can come serve you. But just take the bread and eat that as you like. Hold the cup, and we will partake of that together. I invite you to stand as we sing and as we partake of the communion.
A song, no sin too high, but you have sent it from your
Mark the heart, this
the Lamb of God, slain for the sins of the world, the body and blood of Christ, for our spiritual nourishment, the blood of Christ, shed for remission of sin, the blood of the new covenant, drink from it. Receive the benediction. Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. And God's people said, Amen.